Thank you so much for coming to Michigan, Thomas.
Yes, thank you for the invitation, and thank you for coming, but I guess it's better than being outside. So, genome and transcriptome dynamics in cancer cell is the title of my talk, and what I will do and discuss with you is first the status, what we know about the status quo of chromosomal changes and patterns of aneuploidy in carcinomas. I will touch on the problem of tumor heterogeneity. I will then discuss what the consequences of chromosomal aneuploidy are on the cancer transcriptome, and then I will show you one example of how we can exploit what we have learned from these more basic studies to improve the diagnosis of patients with cancer. So I'm showing you this slide for several reasons. First of all, these are chromosomes from a patient with chronic myelogenous leukemia. And I'm showing you the slide for two reasons. First, you can see here the so-called Philadelphia chromosome translocation, which between chromosome 9 and 22. But you can also see that the rest of the genome is not affected. As you know, at the site of this chromosomal translocation, we generate a fusion gene, and the relevance of this chromosomal translocation and the relevance of the fusion gene is clearly demonstrated by the fact that if you inhibit the tyrosine kinase activity of this gene, then the patients go into remission. So one single operation is required to transform hematological cells, and this is also the paradigm in other leukemias and lymphoma. But the situation in carcinomas, which are tumors of epithelial origin, like breast, colon, cervix, lung, etc., is different. Here you can see I have a normal karyotype. You can appreciate all chromosomes in different colors. And here, in this breast cancer cell line, you clearly will agree with me. There is barely any chromosome that is actually not affected by chromosomal instability, and you have these giant marker chromosomes, which are a reflection of oncogene amplification. So chromosomal instability dominates the carcinomas. And then we have images like that, where we quantitatively stain the nuclear DNA content, and you can clearly appreciate the enormous difference in the DNA content from one cell to another. You can appreciate the reasons for that, which is telomere attrition, which results in anaphase bridges. We have apolar mitosis and lost chromosome aneuploidy. So these two pictures together led to the following perception, for instance, summarized by Bill Hahn. If you look at most solid tumors in adults, it looks like someone set off a bomb in the nucleus. And such interpretations led to the definition of a cytogenetic chaos in solid tumors, which is induced by catastrophic mitosis, karyotypic complexity, clonal heterogeneity, and ongoing chromosomal instability. And in turn, the description or the perception of a cytogenetic chaos led to the interpretation that chromosomal aberrations in the solid tumors are a consequence rather than the cause of cancer. Quite different from the Philadelphia chromosome, where everybody obviously agrees that there is one single event which causes cancer. So let's now look whether this is actually the case. And in order to do so, it's sometimes or almost always necessary to develop methodologies that are suited to address a question. One of the most important was the development of comparative genomic hybridization, where you can map genome-wide losses and gains. Nowadays, it's done on arrays, spectral karyotyping. You can perform interface cytogenetics, where you can label specific chromosomes and enumerate heterogeneity, and nowadays, of course, we can interpret these genomic aberrations together with what they do to the cancer transcriptome. And we initially studied two tumor entities. One is cervical carcinogenesis, the other one colorectal tumorigenesis, and mainly because both are defined by a morphologically well-described sequential transformation of the cells. In colon, of course, it looks different. You have small polyps, large polyps. If you don't do anything, you get invasive disease. And in the cervix, the normal epithelial, low-grade dysplasia, high-grade dysplasia, and invasive disease. And we used these two models and applied appropriate methodologies to ask the following question. Is there a non-random distribution of chromosomal imbalances despite this perceived chaos? Is there a stage-specific sequence of events, and which additional genetic or epigenetic changes do occur to allow this sequential transformation? And here are the results. This is an old slide, but it completely holds true. So we looked at cervical carcinomas. The bars on the right side of the chromosomes indicate gains. The bars on the left side indicate losses. Cervix one is in red. You can immediately appreciate it. We have now performed hundreds of cases in another laboratories that was performed. And here the case numbers are normalized to 10. And you can see that every cervical carcinoma has a gain of that chromosome arm. In other words, it's as common as is the Philadelphia chromosome, CML. You can also appreciate that the colon requires a completely different distribution, yet again, it's exceedingly recurrent. Here we have gains of chromosome 7, loss on the short arm of 8, gain of the long arm of 8, very specific for colorectal tumors, and it occurs only in that disease, a gain of chromosome 13 among others. And we also know that we need additional changes, HPV, of course, invariably in the cervix, and increased proliferative activity, for instance, in patients with ulcerative colitis, predisposes for the acquisition of these tumor type specific genomic imbalances. So I'm showing you one more slide. This is also colon. But here, this is an old study. We looked at liver metastases from colorectal carcinomas using conventional CTH. And these are patients coming from Göttingen and that were analyzed by array CTH. And you can see that despite the fact that you look at primary tumors and metastases, in this case from the liver, the distribution of gains and losses is maintained. You can also appreciate that there are chromosomes that actually cannot be lost, and there are other chromosomes that cannot be gained here and here, indicating that the selective pressure during tumorigenesis, despite ongoing chromosomal instability, is the maintenance of this cancer-specific distribution of chromosomal gains and losses. So, how now? We also know we have to, what did I do? Okay, well, that's better. So we also know that we have what I describe, arguably, an enormous degree of instability, both in terms of copy number and in terms of structural aberrations. So the question is now, how can one reconcile aneuploidy and ongoing chromosomal instability with a strictly conserved pattern of genomic imbalances? And in order to address this point, we have done the following study. Here we looked at ductal carcinoma in situ and invasive ductal carcinoma that occurred in the same patient. Then we dissected these lesions, which you can see here, and prepared single cell suspension on slides. And then we selected a set of fluorescently labeled probes that target chromosomes that are invariably subject to copy number in breast cancer. Is there another pointer? Oh, With that, I cannot advance, right? So, I chuckled 2 pointers. Hopefully. How does it work? You have to. Anyway, while we figure that out, I continue. So we selected a fluorescently labeled probe for regions that are commonly gained or commonly lost in breast cancer. But I cannot advance with that one, right? No. Okay, so and then we did the following. We hybridized these probes to, you can see the identity here, to cells prepared from these cytospins. Then we washed it off, hybridized the next probe panel, and so on and so on. And by in doing so, we were able to visualize the copy numbers of 10 loci in individual cells. And that, in turn, allows you to enumerate copy numbers. In this case of DCIS, and here's always the IDC, you can see you have a gain of the long arm of 1Q, the loss of 8P, 8Q gain, and you can count the number of clones that have this particular distribution. And you would appreciate that here in the pre-invasive lesion, so ductal carcinoma in situ are pre-invasive carcinomas that progress to invasive ductal carcinoma if untreated. So that the pattern is relatively similar, but it allows you to look at these data and then model disease progression. And here's what we saw. In some instances, we had in the ductal carcinoma the same major clone that prevailed in the progression to invasive disease. Here you can see gain 1Q, 8P, 8P gain, 8Q gain, and a 16Q loss. In this case, it's the same. In this case, it's the same. So there is a clonal progression of a lesion that already emerged in the pre-invasive disease. Then we observed other patterns where one of several major clones in the DCIS prevailed and became the major clone in invasive disease. Here, associated with the loss of chromosome 17p. Other clones, initially successful, completely disappeared. Then we had a third category. The major DCIS clone is one of two major clones in the invasive ductal carcinoma. And we had a very often occurring combination where the switch in the major clone involved the gain of extra copies of the MYC oncogene. You can see here, this is a clone initially successful, is reducing copy number, and clones that populate the invasive ductal carcinoma were not even present in the invasive disease, and all this was due to a gain of chromosome 8Q. All these clones that did not have the gain, this completely disappeared. So the take, but if we looked, if we counted these signals and looked at the distribution, despite this instability, we could see that chromosomes that are usually gained in breast cancer are not lost, and chromosomes that usually are lost are not gained. So despite this enormous degree of heterogeneity on the single cell level, the distribution of gains and losses is maintained. So again, this is what is being selected for. So to summarize, chromosomal aneuploidies are a defining feature of carcinomas. The distribution of genomic imbalances is cancer specific. Specific genomic imbalances occur before the transition to invasive disease, and this statement will become important when I discuss the translational application. So, in essence, there is no cytogenetic chaos, but essentially a stability on a different plateau, like a speciation which required cytogenetic changes. And that, I believe, is really something that was important to understand when we try to understand genome dynamics in carcinomas. So then we asked the logical question, is this also required in mouse models of cancer? What are the consequences of these changes of the genomic plateau on the transcriptome? And can we use it for diagnostics? And I'll walk you through there now. So in order to establish models, what we did, we used normal mice. We took epithelial cells from 6 different organs, bladder, cervix, colon, kidney, lung, and mammary gland, and we just put them in culture. So what happens, these cells go through different stages. They become pre-immortal, then immortal, and then they nicely transform. Here, just with an actin stain. And if you inject them, the transformed one into nude mice, they become, they grow tumors, and these tumors are epithelial carcinomas. You can see here, angiogenesis, you have aneuploidy, you have invasion into the muscle layer. So very nicely recapitulated features of human carcinomas. When we looked at the chromosomes, we had again complete chaos. You can see here numerical aberrations, structural aberrations, chromosome bridges, you have micronuclei, you have double minute chromosomes, but extracting the DNA from these, and we could observe something else, which is that in some instances here in the lung, you first have a diploid genome, which then becomes tetraploid, and the basis on the tetraploidization, you lose chromosomes, exactly what we observe in some cases of human tumorigenesis, or you have an initial tetraploidization and based some cells remain diploid, and based on this initial tetraploidization, you then acquire chromosomal instability. But if you do comparative genomic hybridization, you can immediately appreciate that the distribution of genomic imbalances is again disease specific. So you have gain of chromosome 15, you have losses of chromosome 4, and so on. Despite this enormous chromosomal instability. So in other words, it's a good model. And when we then look and compare and ask whether regions that are frequently gained on human chromosomes, such as 8q, as I mentioned before, are also gained on the syntenic region on the mouse chromosome. This is in fact the case. Mouse chromosome 15, as I said, is frequently gained. And another chromosome that is frequently gained, which is short arm chromosome 5, is also on this chromosome. So there are the master chromosomes for tumorigenesis, and the distribution is conserved in evolution. Now, what are the consequences of chromosomal aneuploidy on the cancer transcriptome? And this is really an important question, because you could hypothesize that the expression of all or most genes located on a chromosome is affected by chromosomal gain or loss. Or you could postulate that the expression of only a few genes whose reduced or increased expression is critical for tumorigenesis is the target of chromosomal aneuploidy during tumorigenesis. And if you would be a real good scientist, you should put for number 3 that genomic copy number does not affect gene expression at all. Yes. Yeah, I'll get to that. That is possible. But the first question we wanted to ask, what happens if you have aneuploidy? So in order to study that in a clean system, we used the technique of microcell mediated chromosome transfer to generate artificial chromosomal trisomies in normal cells. And this worked. Here we have immortalized human mammary epithelial cells, wild type, all chromosomes normal. We did this procedure. The chromosome 3 is now in 3 copies, but the rest of the genome is not affected. And then we perform gene expression profiling. You can see here the baseline. Some genes are, of course, up, some genes are down. But if you look at the chromosome that is now in three copies, you can see that there is a massive general upregulation of most genes. And so aneuploidy results in a significant increase of average message levels of genes on the affected chromosomes. The degree of increase closely follows genomic copy number. These effects are independent of the introduced chromosomes and independent of cell type. Therefore, chromosomal aneuploidies not only target a few specific genes, but result in a massive and complex deregulation of the cancer transcriptome. And this, by the way, is also the case in the constitutional chromosomal aneuploidies. And there, as you know, there are three chromosomes, chromosome 13, 18, and 21, by which there is impaired, but at least some development possible. So you would ask the question, so why chromosome 13, even though it's much bigger than chromosome 22 or chromosome 19? It's solely a function of the number of genes on those chromosomes. So chromosome 13 and chromosome 18 and chromosome 22 have the fewest genes. That therefore it can be tolerated. It tolerated, but cancer cells obviously can tolerate it better. So we then asked the question, okay, we do this experiment over and over. Is the deregulation of the transcriptome stochastic, or do we always see the same result? And lo and behold, so we painstakingly repeated these experiments. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 repeats. You can see again the average upregulation of transcription, but you can also see, and I was completely surprised, a remarkable consistency of genes that are very highly upregulated, or in a few instances, a gene that is downregulated. And potentially that is what we can use to answer your question, which one are the drivers? Because you would assume that those guys that go really high up have a higher relevance. But we can still not formally exclude the possibility that the tissue specificity of these aneuploidies requires many more than the obvious candidate genes on these chromosomes. We entertain the idea that these genes that are where the cell really must go through a lot of hoopla hoop to keep them down would be potential therapeutic target, because you could argue if you upregulate those, then it is toxic for the cell. The advantage, of course, would be that this situation is not found in normal cells, so there is hope to predict that it would be a more specific cancer treatment. But we aren't there yet. You can also appreciate, by the way, that the results are extremely reproducible in these biological replicates. So it's always a very similar effect as a consequence of the aneuploidy. This is also the case in tumors. You can see here in these two cases, a genome-wide correlation of copy number, and it's also found on the level of specific genes. So in summary, here we have in blue, we have a normal genome. We have the gene expression levels in red. We have cancer genome where DNA is lost or DNA is gained. You can see how closely the average gene expression level follow the genomic copy number. So in this case, function follows the form. And the fact that we published so many papers on that issue shows you that we consider that a central question in tumor genesis. So now a few slides on another aspect, mostly because related questions are asked in a collaboration with Indica here in Michigan. So, and this is aimed at understanding the relationship of aneuploidy gene expression and nuclear architecture. And why is it important to ask this question? Because we know from work mostly from the Gramer group that gene-rich chromosomes, here chromosome 19 in green, are usually in the center of the nucleus, and gene-poor chromosomes, here 18, are in the periphery. So we asked the question whether aniploid chromosomes assume a conserved position. And in order to do so, of course, we used our model system where we introduced artificial chromosomes. The measurement done as follows. Here we have the center of the nucleus. This is the edge of the nucleus. Here you have the the normal wild-type cell, the distribution of chromosome 7, which is also gene-poor. Chromosome 18 more in the periphery, chromosome 19 more interior. And if you look at the introduced chromosomes, you can see they assume the same position. So while it does not tell us that this is required for the respective transcription, we can conclude that artificially induced chromosomes are transcriptionally active and assume a conserved position. So to summarize this part of the talk, we have a normal cell with a stable chromosome complement. At one of the early steps, and maybe triggered by chronic inflammation, I mentioned ulcerative colitis, which is associated with a greatly increased colorectal cancer risk. We have HPV infection, which impairs RB and P53 as one of the major guardians of the genome. We have hyperproliferation, or, and I think that's important, we just have a cell cycle accident. Because everybody agrees if DNA is replicated, there are mistakes made, despite the fact that there is a proofreading system. I would argue if you have, and I forgot the number, but I calculated it, and we discussed it already. I think we have more than a billion cell division per day in our bodies. So it is entirely consistent with my thinking that at some point there goes wrong. If you are old, then you have more cancer. You had more cell divisions. If you are, I just came back from a conference and there were data that male have a higher incidence than female, and it could be a reflection that the average body size of male is larger than of women. There are also examples, in particular from Great Danes, who have very long bones and who obviously have more cell divisions to make a big bone, because the cells are the same size than in a, what is a small dog, whatever, a small. Right. So they have a greatly increased incidence of osteosarcoma, which are the cells that make the bone long. So, okay. Anyway, I think it's important to keep in mind that you maybe don't need an a priori genetic change or a P53 mutation. You can have just have a cell cycle accident, and if it is the right chromosome in the right tissue, you have a proliferative advantage. And I will show you that in a few minutes. So if then in the dysplastic cell you have an extra copy of a chromosome, we know that the chromosome assumes position, like in wild type. We know from P53 studies, for instance, in colorectum, that P53 is not yet mutated in polyps, but we do see an extra copy of chromosome 7. The nuclear, what I call nuclear aneuploidy, is still low, so these are still very stable from one cell to another, but the chromosomal aneuploidy is present. We know that trisomies affect global gene expression levels, and I'll show you, we know once that has happened, this is the basis for clonal expansion. This is the proliferative advantage that a cell has. And then if it's not treated, as we have seen, we have numerous chromosomes, but by and large, those that occur early are still maintained despite chromosomal instability, as I've shown. We now know that we have a large degree of chromosomal instability, i.e. what I call nuclear aneuploidy is high. We have genomic aneuploidy, which persists, which is consistent with the CGH results, and we have localized events now. So and now this is all fine. And then if you go back to more than 100 years ago, and this is Theodor Boveri, who was a zoologist at the university in Würzburg in Germany. So he didn't even study cancer. But he wrote a book about cancer, The Origin of Malignant Tumors. Here the English translation, which appeared in, 1929, but the original book was written in 1919 in German. So I found it in a rare bookstore. So I had to pay $250, so that would have been a good investment. Anyway, so he looked at sea urchin eggs, and sometimes after fertilization he noticed these structures attached to chromosomes, and he actually called them centrosomes. He coined that term. And you can clearly see that they pull the chromosomes. And then he, looking at these cells, he hypothesized that if this is indeed the case, then there must be daughter cells that have either too many or too few chromosomes, invariably. And he even did some modeling, which I didn't show here. It's very beautiful work. And then he concluded, to assume the presence of definite chromosomes which inhibit division would harmonize best with my fundamental idea. Cells of tumors with a limited growth would arise if those, he called them inhibiting chromosomes, were eliminated. On the other hand, the assumption of the existence of chromosomes which promote division might satisfy this postulate. On this assumption, cell division would take place when the action of these chromatin parts, which are as a rule too weak, should be strengthened by a stimulus, and the unlimited tendency to rapid proliferation in malignant tumor cells would be deduced from a permanent predominance of the chromosomes which promote division. And there you have it. So we could have used NIH money for something else. the term chromosome was chromatin, I don't know, the word chromosome was coined by a German pathologist, Waldeyer, in 1888. So, So he actually, he was, you should read the book, if you, because it's really a beautiful piece of work. I have also written a review about him. If you, the weather stays like that, you can read that too. He actually also was the one, together with Sutton in New York, who postulated that chromosomes are the carriers of the genetic information. Very clean thinking. All right, let's move on to the last topic and the application to diagnostics. As I've shown you, the distribution of gains and losses is non-random, and I have also shown you that they occur before the transition to invasive disease. I have also shown you that that is not important in this context, that they are different in different tumor entities. So, what is two things that are for diagnostic applications most relevant? The distribution is conserved, so it's always there. What is always also important, that it's never observed in normal tissue. And thirdly, it's important that they occur before the transition to invasive disease, because we do not want to diagnose cancer. We want to diagnose a premalignant lesion that can be cured with surgery alone. And this is the case for cervical dysplasia. That is the case for polyps in the colon. So that's why it's so important that they occur early as one of the first genome mutations. Cervical carcinoma, you know that the incidence of carcinoma, which is shown here, has been greatly reduced in countries where the pap staining is routine. Despite the fact cervical cancer is still the most common cancer in female worldwide. So it's horrendous burden. And we now collaborate with a group in Costa Rica, and they send us cancer samples. You have no idea how horrible these look. So, but back to the cytology, you see that the normal cervical cells have every characteristic. So they have a large cytoplasm and a small nucleus. And clearly the cancer cells are different here in contrast to a normal cell amongst the cancer cells. So the cytological diagnosis of cancer, you would agree, is not difficult. The problem in cervical, in pap smear screening, is that the low-grade dysplastic lesions that are already HPV positive, at least most of them, are harder to distinguish from those. But the biggest problem is that we know from epidemiological studies that only 15% of the low-grade dysplastic lesions progress to a lesion that requires treatment. But despite infection with high-risk papilloma virus, 85% regress. And there is no way, by looking at these low-grade dysplasias, to tell which one are the good guys and which one are the bad guys. That is accepted. And the reason why a pap smear is repeated so often is because of that insecurity. You just don't know. A further problem is, in particular in this country, because of the legal system, that the gynecologists are very eager to treat those because they don't know which one are the one that progress, and then they're gonna get sued. The problem is the follow-up diagnosis of a low-grade or high-grade pap smear requires surgical intervention, either a biopsy or conization. And conization, these are mostly young women, then comes with an increased risk for miscarriages. So it's first of all invasive. Second of all, it has consequences. Third, it's expensive. And fourth, and most important, in 85%, it would not even be necessary. That's the problem, and that is a problem. So we hypothesized, if all cervical carcinomas have a gain of 3Q, and no normal cervical epithelium has a gain of 3Q, and we know that some of these changes occur early, we can detect these copy numbers on routinely collected pap smears. And in order to do so, we developed a FISH test using the most likely target on this region of chromosome 3Q, which is the human telomerase gene, and then control probes just to facilitate the counting. And we hybridized these probe sets to pap smears. Here you can see normal 222. Here you can see in this, this is called cervical intraepithelial neoplasia. This is a moderate dysplasia, 3 copies of this gene. You can see in some carcinomas, you have clouds of this chromosome. This is a high-level amplification, which I don't know if there are cytopathologists. This is how it would look like if you have a HER2-new amplification in breast cancer. So a massive, massive amplification, and here are just some other examples. So that was that was completely clear. That was easy. And now I'm showing this for a reason. So we have a pap smear here, stained with a pap stain, and then we destained it and hybridized it here. You can see here this normal cell, two copies, another normal cell, two copies. But then you can see this nest of cells, and they have all the same clonal aberrations. And this is what I meant before. If you acquire in a cell division an extra copy of a chromosome in the right tissue, this is then the reason for the clonal expansion, because this is clonal expansion because your cells are next to each other. So again, supporting the notion that this is the most important genome mutation in solid tumor, in the genesis of solid tumors. We confirmed that, of course, in the histology after the patients were biopsied, and you can see you have the same. This is the PAP, this is the copy number in the tissue. So we could establish that the gain of TERC has the highest sensitivity and specificity for the detection of histologically confirmed high-grade dysplasia. And then we did the following study. Then we really wanted to know whether progression of early lesions can be attributed to this specific aneuploidy. And we did a validation study. We looked at, excuse the terminology, this is, again, this is high-grade dysplasia. This is low-grade dysplasia. This is just a histological term, cervical intraepithelial neoplasia. So we looked at a group of women that were diagnosed with high-grade lesion, even though they were enrolled in PEPS. So that is something that should not happen. And all of them, we then collected the low-grade dysplasias that was diagnosed before. Then we selected another group of women with the same low-grade dysplasia, but in the sequential Pap smear, they returned to normal. And then we also selected a group of women with high-grade dysplasia or invasive cervical carcinoma, but before the Pap smear was normal, which is suspicious because we know that the progression from low-grade dysplasia to invasive carcinoma takes years. So we hypothesized, the end of the story, that the high-grade lesions and the carcinomas are positive for 3Q, and they were invariably. We hypothesized that the lesions that showed progression were all already positive for 3Q, and they were. Never did we observe a gain of 3Q in the lesions that regressed. Again, showing the point, despite the infection of HPV, the point of no return in cervical carcinogenesis is reached once we have this specific aneuploidy. Black and white. And I mean, you might think these numbers are not high, but we have now done hundreds. And others have, the Quest is actually now offering this test as well. And then we looked at the women that had a normal Pap smear, and then after relatively short latency, had an invasive carcinoma. And long and behold, a third of them was already positive for this marker, despite the fact that they were enrolled in a screening program. So, and here are just some examples to close a low-grade dysplasia. In this case, this was a patient that regressed two copies. Here another example. Here a high-grade dysplasia, three copies. Here again, you can three copies. This woman progressed. You can again beautifully appreciate this. These cells obviously are daughter cells from one mother cell, and they have the same clonal composition. And then another example. And then this was a very tragic case. This woman was twice, the Pap smear was twice assessed as being normal. And then after 2 years, she had an invasive carcinoma. And then we went back, and then you could see that the normal Pap smear already had a gain of 3Q. So in this case, by just looking at a single FISH marker, you could have prevented invasive cancer with all the consequences. And my major frustration with that is that it is so difficult to convince cytopathologists to do the test. Even though, I mean, you don't have to do anything in addition because the samples are already there. So it was I lost many hairs in this. in this process. So it's now getting track and appreciated. But I again think one of the reasons why it took so long is because they all had this wrong conception of chromosomal instability and chaos and could not see that that could be translated. It's actually not the case. You just have to count. Another, I think, advantage of this test is that it's obviously, you cannot make a mistake. I mean, you can, your five-year-old be a better cytopathologist than someone who has been in the business for 40 years, because the only thing that you have to be able to do is discern, is to count to two or not to two. So anyway, so this is the story. So I think it's a very valuable complementation of the cytomorphology, of the cytomorphologically based evaluation in the diagnosis of solid tumors. With that, of course, the most important slide, or the diagnostic, most of the diagnostic work was done with, by Kirsten with her student, where is she? Amanda. Jordi did a lot of the colorectal work. Dara introduced the chromosomes. Hesed and Nicole work on the mouse models. Yui is the statistician. And that's the collaborations listed here. And very happy that we will have a collaboration with Indica. So his enthusiasm when I'm frustrated is very helpful. yeah, with that, I want to close. And thank you for your attention. Questions?
So when you induce trisome cells, you see some genes to be reproducibly overexpressed, but it's still hard to tell which are the driver.
Yeah, it's still hard to tell, but you can also actually now knock these that are highly overexpressed down with siRNA and see whether that would affect viability more than the others.
So since these are tissue specific, if you induce the trisomy on different cell types, many other cell types, could that narrow it down for you?
That I do not know. The problem is it's not so easy to do this microcell mediated chromosome transfer. So I do not know. Yes. But it's a good experiment.
Had exhibited some kind of control on the proliferation of the aneuploidy. Is there some kind of higher level regulation that occurs at the tissue level? And a lot of this comes in cell culture, but
No. This doesn't come from cell culture. This is from tissue.
Mm-hmm. Well, from I understand cancer, from cancer tissue. Smears and other. Yeah. But I'm just wondering if there's something that happens at the level of the tissue that explains some of the distribution and the proliferation of the, the multiplication and proliferation and the heterogeneity that you see. Mm-hmm. Of that nature.
That I cannot answer. I don't know. But what I entertain as a possibility is as a possible explanation for the tissue specificity, uh-huh, is that maybe the genes on these chromosomes are not a priori cancer genes, but required for the physiology of the cell,
right,
which is different in a cervix than in a colon. Yep. I think that is a distinct possibility, because we know if cells are under stress, they become tetraploid,
yep,
or octoploid even. So it's like having the same size car but a bigger engine. But maybe you don't need the whole engine, but just the cylinders. And in the cervix, it's the cylinders, and in the colon, it's the gas injection pump or whatever it's called. But the size of the radiator doesn't matter. So we are now trying to do RNA sequencing on normal tissue to see whether that is in fact the case.
Yeah, thanks. Dave, that was what I was asking.
So I have a question, and I'll yell, so it doesn't have to walk up here for much. But you know that some of the chromosomal aneuploidies result in widespread population. So what extent do you think that's the result of what is essentially a dysregulation of RNAs, which are not normally thought of as, you know, the transcriptome, like all RNAs, non-coding RNAs,
Likely. But when we introduce a chromosome, not only the genes on that chromosome go up, we have non-stochastic effects on genes on other chromosomes. So we are now looking whether transcription factors that are upregulated as a consequence of the aneuploidy regulate the genes that are downstream deregulated. Well, chromothripsis, as you know, is a rare event. We have data that, despite the fact that we observe chromothripsis, we still have the tissue-specific distribution of chromosomal gains and losses. So I think chromothripsis is the pulverization of a chromosome, and curiously, it's only in a predefined region. So I think chromothripsis, first of all, is a late event. I think, and we have data, it is a reflection of a particularly poor prognosis. The reason for that, I don't know, because we also know that those cases that show poor prognosis not only had chromothripsis, but also a higher degree of chromosomal instability. So I don't know which one is the main event. Yes. Oh, you first.
Yeah. The question I have is, in the cell, is there any mechanism that actually try to prevent any aneuploidies to happen? Is there any particular machines or like a protein complex regulator?
Well, of course, you have mitotic checkpoints that, or to prevent the missegregation of chromosomes, you have or mirotelic attachments or things like that. But and maybe I cannot exclude the possibility that the majority of the cells in the cervix that have a gain of 3q apoptose. I don't know. Nobody knows. But I can tell you the patterns of clonal expansion make me think that they expand and the consistency, but I cannot, maybe it's the case. But then again, I mean, look at the cervix. You have HPV infection. So the guard is down. So so maybe actually what we now that you say that, maybe what we should look. No, actually we did that. We did the same approach that I showed for the breast cancer, where we looked at the 10 probes. We did it for cervical dysplasia and for cervical for associated invasive carcinoma, and it's an early event. And in some cases it's just 3q. So you would not have to suppose that there is an increased average chromosomal instability, but what we should do more interface fish. and deletions and see whether other chromosomes are also affected and whether that is then just a matter of selection of the right chromosome. I agree. But syndromes associated with an increase of chromosome instability in the germline, I forgot the name now, but I think it's BAP1, they have greatly increased cancer risk. For what? We count. In the lab, we so far count manually because we are not a diagnostic lab. But there are systems out that from several companies that do automated spot counting. It's actually used for a new vision bladder cancer. So that's a possibility. So you can count many cells. Okay, thank you again.
Thanks for a bit of trouble.
Hi, how are you? Thank you.